Last Pint Productions presents the New Way podcast. The New Way contains adult content, and new episodes are released most Wednesdays. So back off, man. We're professionals. Listener discretion is advised.
So you were in Vietnam, if I'm not mistaken?
Yeah.
Were you in the shit?
Yeah, I was in the shit.
Last night, Darth Vader came down from planet Vulcan and told me that if I didn't take Lorraine out, that he'd melt my brain.
Here's how you get him. He pulls a knife, you pull a gun. He sends one of yours to the hospital, you send one of his to the morgue.
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass.
Everybody wants to be naked and famous. Everybody wants to be just like me, I'm naked.
Will you help teach me about this? What is it? A new way?
Hello and welcome once again to the New Way Podcast, where we break down pop culture so you don't have to. I'm your host, Matt Schenk, joined by my co-host, Mr. Benjamin Scott Wilson.
Oh, hi.
And filling in the Nick seat tonight, the hot seat, because Nick is on location covering the Jerry Springer funeral out in Los Angeles. But we have in his stead Mr. Ken Posner, who is doing a rare back-to-back podcast for the New Way, which is quite a feat. So welcome, Ken.
Great to be back in Burbank, Johnny.
That's good. And Ken also upgrading his sound system and sounding quite professional tonight.
Sounding beautiful, yeah.
I appreciate it. Yeah, I found a good deal.
And I thought it was canon, though. I mean, in true Requiem of a Dream fashion, that if you do two episodes back to back, it's actually ass to ass, right?
If you say it three times, Nick will appear and go ass to ass, and that
does
will
it
happen.
Have to be in front of a mirror.
You will just invoke the Nick ass to ass, no matter where you are, mirror okay, or not.
I was told it was the actual actor, David Hayes, right?
Keith David. There we go.
I always invert them. The other one is the bad guy in Major League 2.
Right. Yes.
I remember that we used to have that issue with Craig Daniels and Daniel Craig back before Daniel Craig was a household name. And that was a cause for some discussion. And in fact, I believe we had that discussion at a viewing of Road to Perdition, where your brother Ben almost ruined the movie for me, because that was the day that he told me that beforehand, he goes, no matter what, in every Tom Hanks movie, there's some moment where he goes full Hanks. And we're like, well, Ben, he probably won't do that in Road to Perdition. I'm sure it won't happen at a very serious and important part of the movie. And of course, when, spoiler alert, his family is murdered and he comes upstairs and he just goes, nah! And your brother just turned to me and goes, your brother goes, I told you.
Listen, you can take the guy out of Bosom Buddies. You cannot take the Bosom Buddy out of the guy.
Yeah, you know that the Hanks has to come out at least one moment, just for 7 seconds.
Bringing out the Hanks.
The Hanks will out.
Yes, exactly.
So because we don't have Nick, and I think we may, you know, I think we'll probably go through our topic a little bit faster than we did our religious films, which I think we're going to need 7 more podcasts to actually get through. I haven't had a lot of time to set this up, but I did... before we get to this, are there any interesting pop culture tidbits or news worthy moments or things that you guys have seen or heard, or maybe you're watching something on the telly that you want to talk about?
I wasn't going to bring it up at first because Nick isn't here. We got into a text conversation because Nick went to see the new Evil Dead. I went to see the new Evil Dead, but now then I realize Nick is not on the podcast. So it gives me my chance to tell my perspective without any sort of repercussion or sort of rebuttal from him.
Perfect.
Which is the best of all worlds, I think. And I think the audience would agree. No, I'm just joking. I really was hoping to have a quick discussion with him, because actually I don't think we're that far off, because Nick said he didn't really enjoy it. I actually enjoyed it. And then after I texted with Nick, I think that Nick was probably probably being a little bit hyperbolic. Impossible. Because I actually enjoyed the movie, understanding that it is super flawed and that it is definitely not like you know, it's not as good as the critics or a lot of the major horror fanboys are making it out to be by any stretch of the imagination. I still found it enjoyable. And then I realized also it's exactly a carbon copy of the very first Evil Dead movie, problems and all. Like, people don't realize that's a problematic movie from a pacing standpoint, and that it tries to be two different things at once. And it really just got a cult following based off of how over the top that last act goes. And the same thing happens in this movie, where it's like, it's a completely different movie. And then the last act, it's just like, nope, we're just going to go completely batshit crazy bananas.
And I will, I'll be honest. So this was barely on my radar. So if I understand correctly, this takes place in like a building or a house or all I could think of is it reminded me of the plot of Poltergeist 4. Which took place, it was like obviously a studio executive saw Die Hard and they were like, you know what would be great if we did Poltergeist Die Hard and we made it happen in an apartment building with what's his name, Tom Skerritt as the lead in it. But am I correct that this takes place with kids in some sort of building?
Yes. So okay. It just takes place in an apartment.
Okay.
Basically. And they do a good job, I mean, at least until the last act where it kind of expands on the location a little bit. And there's a bookend to the piece that doesn't really involve the main storyline. But it does a good job. It's basically, there's some claustrophobia, you know, that kind of gets in with the fact that they're kind of stuck in a place without power, you know, for relatively legitimate reasons and whatever. Okay. It definitely plays up... as opposed to being a cabin in the woods, it's this, you know, L.A. apartment, you know, that, you know, is clearly an old historical, like it used to be a hotel, one of those types of places, you know, and feels a little.
We've talked about this a few times on the podcast, but it's not easy to do. But I like when a movie is able to make a place that is not inherently scary or doesn't lend itself to horror. And the one that always pops to my head is Cloverfield. Because Cloverfield was one of those things that it, like, much more than a Godzilla movie or anything that came before it, it felt like I was watching a real event happening around people in a real city. To the point at which I remember I got back to my townhouse I was living at the time, and I remember just looking around like my surroundings and just being like, what would I do if there was a Cloverfield monster like attacking North Palm Beach?
Well, and that's a good point, although I would say that that's more of like an anxiety. Like, I get exactly the same thing that you got. And that one of the reasons why I still think Cloverfield, what Matt Reeves did in that movie, is super effective, is because it like creates this kind of general anxiety and suspense around, like, yeah, like you feel like you're at the ground level of this thing. I was never scared watching Cloverfield, but I do think there are some other interesting movies where you take a location, you know, that isn't particularly or maybe potentially you would think completely scary, or ones where it just kind of turns it. What's the one with the Aztec mine where they're on the top of the mine? It's got
Ghostbusters.
No.
It was the first thing I thought.
No.
The end of Crystal Skull, which was terrifyingly bad.
Funny enough, I actually own it, and it's
The Covenant.
No, it's escaping me for some reason. Covenant's Ty West.
I'm just throwing horror movies at. I don't know
The Descent.
No, it's not The Descent. No, it's actually there. It's like basically these people are climbing. They're hiking. You know, you climb to the top of these. Like, you can see the top of it from the bottom. It's like not a very scary thing. And they get to the top, and then the plants.
The ruins
come down. Yeah, the ruins. There you go. Oh. It's got Jenna Malone in it.
I don't think this has ever been, but Ben Stiller exec produced.
It's a bottleneck. It's one of those bottleneck movies where it's an hour and a half of just like, hey, you get stuck in this crazy, weird situation that where nothing makes sense and you have to get out of it. You know, it's kind of like imagine 47 meters down, but instead of being at the bottom of the ocean, you're at the top of a Mayan pyramid.
Huh. Interesting.
I don't think I've ever seen it.
I like the cast. Sean Ashmore, Joe Anderson.
God damn it.
It's been a really long day, guys. I'm so sorry. I'm not at peak level tonight.
And Jenna Morass.
The ruined asshole. Yes, I see this movie. Oh, wait, I might be on one of the porn parodies of it.
Anyways, to bring it back to Evil Dead, I would say, like, I would cautiously recommend it. I'm just saying, hey, it's going to get weird. But it's worth it as a parent, too, just how far they take the whole parental and family type of thing. And basically just kind of like the whole time I'm like, well, they can't kill that. Oh, no. Like, it's pretty much all holds barred, no holds barred.
So I take it then that Beth would not ever want to watch this film.
Yeah, Beth has a problem just seeing kids in danger.
Yeah.
That's why I was just like, I saw that by myself at 8:30 at night at the local movie. I was like, I have a movie credit to use. I'm going to see this on my own volition.
How about you, Ken? Anything in the pop culture world you're excited about that you're watching, consuming, heard news about?
I work with a lot of, 50 and 60 year olds, so they're all recommending The Diplomat. Check that out.
This is the show,
Keri Russell's return to TV with a great Rufus Sewell, who I've always really enjoyed and never, maybe he's, I don't know why he didn't really sort of make it, although he is in one of the movies.
We are going to talk about a movie of his quite a bit tonight.
How dare you imply that the star of Dark City, Kenneth Branagh's Hamlet, what was the movie with Ed Norton? The Illusionist. Yes, the bad guy in The Illusionist.
God, is he?
The one that I like that's a very underrated movie. I can never remember the name of it. Where is it? Dangerous Beauty. Have you guys seen Dangerous Beauty? Is a phenomenally good movie that should be like a straight, like it's sold like a Cinemax late night sex movie, but it is not. It is absolutely not that. It is phenomenally good. Oliver Platt is in it, and Catherine McCormick. We gotta love the Oliver Platt and Rufus Sewell in one movie. Do I need to say anything else to sell you on this? I mean, come on.
Yeah, I mean, I used to confuse them all the time. That that film disabused me of the fact that they were possibly the same person.
You think that Oliver Platt is a character that Rufus Sewell has been playing because he couldn't get roles in his own thing, so he just dressed up as like, this guy really and like I'm Oliver Platt. Character.
He's like what's it, the
he's Andy Tony Clifton. Kaufman. Yeah, Tony Clifton. That is amazing.
And then the other thing was that Warner Brothers, felt so emboldened by what they had with The Flash that they showed it to like all of the influencers and exhibitors, and with pretty much unanimous like across the board being like, oh, this DC did something really good here. Which I had said in our text chain that I'm not super surprised by because it was directed by Andy Muschietti, who is a strong filmmaker. For those who don't know, he did the It movies,
Mama.
He did Mama. I think he did the American remake of Wreck, but he's also done some Spanish language stuff as well. But it's just a strong filmmaker, though this is outside of the kind of horror genre. He usually does.
No, yeah. I mean, I think, I was excited by his involvement. It sounds like the story is pretty great. It's interesting that, I really like the trailers they've been showing. Obviously, they're very Batman heavy. Batman 89 and Affleck Batman, it was really interesting listening to him on the Smartless podcast saying, like, he goes, took me till this movie to finally get, like, the Batman character and get it under, like, actually figure out a way to play it. And he's like, now I'm done. He's like, is there any way I can maybe do one more of these?
Yeah, I read those quotes where he's just like, fuck.
He's like, he was funny as hell. Just like, he goes, I was in the middle of a scene where Wonder Woman has the lasso of truth around me and everything starts coming out of Bruce Wayne. And he was like, holy shit, I fucking, after five of these movies, get why I was interested in this character and now it's over. I will say, and this is going to be not in character for me because I do tend to like a lot of fan service. I really, really did not like the let's get nuts delivered in the trailer by Keaton's Batman. in the Flash trailer. It was just, it was the only thing. I like everything else about it. I love older Keaton getting a chance in the role.
To me, I mean, do you think it's in the movie? Because it feels like one of those things that's maybe not in the movie.
I have a feeling it's absolutely in the movie, and I have a feeling it's like one of those tentpole moments in it that they've built in, and they put it in the trailer, which I hate. I hate both parts of it. I hate it, A, that it's in the trailer, and B, that it likely will happen in the movie, and it's the only thing that took me out of it.
I mean, I guess we'll find out if it's, you know, if it's in the picture or not. But, you know, it is another example of fan service going awry, you know, kind of stuff. Like, I mean, don't treat me like a child. Like, I can see new stuff and enjoy it.
And the irony is like the line in the original Batman is so weirdly unhinged and out of place. That's the reason why it's memorable. It doesn't really fit in. And it's just like, and it's so bizarre that became like something that we remember out of Batman 89. It should be like that moment that we cringe about. Like
he wasn't
Storm's toad line in X-Men. Yeah. You know, it's like the stuff, it should be one of the things that we remember for a bad reason.
Yeah.
It
should be a parody of itself.
Yeah. Right? No, that's what it feels like the Pete Holmes, Batman parodies, where like this was like Batman trying out catchphrases, and they were like, and they were just progressively worse than the level. And one of them was just like, "You want to get nuts?" And he's like, "Oh no, that was pretty good." Like, no, that's a very bad Bruce Wayne.
You want my nuts?
Much better. So, it was the only thing. I like everything else I've seen from it. I mean, other than that, obviously Ezra Miller has soured for me like milk, milk.
It's Ezra Miller time. Where is it?
Keeping the faith was last week.
Yes,
he's got the talent, but he may not have the tools.
Listen, so. I've been preparing to audition for Ragtime in a Jewish role, and this is really just part of it. Also doing my penance because I've been doing a lot of Heil Hitlers for the producers' rehearsals. So, which I've turned into Hey Buddies. Because it has the same cadence and is less confusing. But
interestingly, the more of those you do, the Heil Hitlers, then the quicker you can get a Swiss bank account. So I say keep doing it. You know, financial planning.
What if tomorrow, like, what if after I post this podcast, all of a sudden our listenership in like Argentina goes up 50-fold? Like, and we're like, wonder where that spike came from. That's so weird. Yeah.
The bots were just looking for those hot Heil Hitlers.
I know this is going to go right onto YouTube and it's going to get crawled and probably pulled down. But hey, you know what? Maybe they'll replace it with Hey Buddy as well. So I'm super excited about something I have. And I don't think we're going to go through a full one of these. We'll probably do it for a podcast. But Ken, we have played from time to time on this podcast a movie pitch game that I kind of put together where I took some actors and I found a fake title. And we picked a genre and each of us would pitch a movie kind of in a short amount of time. Now, this was somewhat based on a game that had not been released yet that was a Kickstarter program that I think I sponsored 4 years ago, but it finally arrived. And it is called Made Up Movies. And Made Up Movies is a little bit more involved than some of the other ones, but I've got kind of what they recommend for they call it the universal pitch template. And what this is it's almost like Mad Libs where you're filling in with things that are on these cards right here. Mm-hmm. So you'll say, this is a reboot of, and you'll pull a movie card, and it's starring star number one and star number two, and it's a insert genre set with a setting, and then you say, think this movie meets this movie, and it's called. So the way this one works, and I literally just opened this up 2 minutes before the podcast, so I don't even know the rules, but it sounds like this one is literally that you are just picking a name for this movie, that you want to title a movie that I'm going to pitch to you. So I'm going to pose this to you guys, and I imagine the game is much more involved, and there's some more nuance to it of other things, but I thought this would be kind of fun for us to do. They also do have they have studio executive notes cards, which I think are hysterical to have things where it's like, describe the villain in this movie. And I thought that was kind of funny. But we're gonna try this, right, guys?
Before you start this, I just have to mention something really quick. Earlier, Ken, your cat like jumped up next to you and you were petting your cat. But because you have the automatic background blurring
thing on. Please tell me you're going to say the mist.
It looked like you were just like... like touching a ghost beside you.
Before you weren't even touching anything, but it was moving. And I swear to God, all I was thinking, I was looking at Ben to see if he said, I was thinking it was the mist. I basically felt like you were Thomas Jane at the end of the mist, and there's just these creatures. There's something out there in the mist.
Don't worry, I'm gonna be okay. But
first, because I was just like, what the fuck is Ken doing? He's just like rubbing the
fondling
air.
The air.
I was gonna use the word fondle. But yes.
And then I was like, the air is moving. What is moving? What is happening? And then I was like, oh, he's everything else is out of focus. You're just stroking your.
Yes. All right,
as one does.
So we're gonna try one of these and see how it goes here. So I'm gonna give you this sentence with these things. So let me pull out the cards. I need three movie cards. I need two star cards, not to be confused with scars guards, which are different.
You need
things.
Two scars guards.
I need two we'll on that. Stars guards.
Every
I'm guard.
Year I'm discovering a new scars guard. And there's more.
Yeah. They are like planets. They come out of nowhere. I need a genre card. I need a setting card. Where the hell is that? Oh, there we go.
Do you think they started a fencing club called On Scars Guard?
I love it.
That's fantastic, man.
Do they fence in Scandinavia? It seems so French to me.
I think they sell stolen goods there, but they might. Look at that. Look at us all so smart tonight.
I like that. That was.
We're gonna get Ken on here, and we all just get real fancy and highfalutin. It's fantastic. Yeah. All right,
it's like a gravity well.
So here we are gonna go. Here we go. You guys are gonna tag team the title for this movie, or we can all do it. Actually, I can play along with this well. Yeah. So this is a reboot of Dumb and Dumber, starring. Starring Al Pacino. And Jason Momoa.
Yes. This would get greenlit right now, by the way. This would absolutely get greenlit.
It is a murder mystery. Set in a giant treehouse.
That's tough.
And I want you to think Wedding Crashers meets Snakes on a Plane. Oh, and this movie is called what? Or how do we even pitch this movie?
Wait. It's a remake of Dumb and Dumber.
Yes. A reboot.
A reboot of Dumb and Dumber that takes place in, that's a murder mystery that takes place in a treehouse.
A giant treehouse.
It's like Wedding Crashers meets what?
And it's a murder. Yeah, it's
Snakes on a Plane.
Snakes on a Plane. And starring Al Pacino and Jason Momoa. I'm just cast alone. I almost wish they were doing Heat and this was just Heat 2.
I was thinking Twins.
Ooh, yeah, it is Twins-esque. I do like. So we, what's if this was an honest trailer?
Well, to me, I was thinking Step Brothers kind of is like something along those lines. But
the treehouse for sure.
In the treehouse.
The treehouse. Yeah, that one really throws. First of all, I love the idea of a murder mystery that takes place just in a giant treehouse, and that's all you've got. It's pretty
classic Agatha Christie, like single room kind of murder.
You know? Yeah, just a single room murder with just two men.
Of them, you know. Yeah.
The chipmunk cometh.
the Keebler selves the Keeb and Keebler. Like, they could be just Keebler elves and they're giant. They both play Keebler elves in a giant treehouse, and they've murdered one of the other elves. So I'm going with Keeb and Keebler.
I still think that, I mean, just based off of, you know, the insomnia credit in all of the movies and Heat and everything he's played in, I think Pacino has to play the detective, the bumbling, you know, dumb and dumber detective who has to come and, you know, it's Momoa's treehouse. So
is that the sequel to Pee Wee's Playhouse? Hey kids, it's Momoa's treehouse.
The basement.
All right, so my vote is I'm going with Keeb and Keebler. Ben, you're going with
I'm gonna say it's give me 13 seconds.
Okay, Ken.
I mean, I'm still thrown by the Snakes on a Plane thing. I'm going to go with, I think there's a political dimension we're missing here. I'm going to go with Hanging Chads.
Hanging Chads. They're both named Chad.
I do like, and they're hanging. They're just hanging out.
They're hanging out in a treehouse.
And maybe there's someone that's been hung in the treehouse, and that's the secret. You don't know that going in, but you're going to have a hanging Chad as well.
That's it.
I like it. I like it.
We're doing this on the fly.
That's how we do all of the show. There's no prep in the new way. Ben is thinking very hard.
Yeah, right now. I got nothing. I'll just go with the tree of knife. There you
go. I like it. I like it. Our listeners can write in, send a self-addressed stamped envelope to Last Pint Productions. Let us know which of these three titles you are most likely to go see in the movie theater. Now, getting on to our topic, this was kind of fun coming up with this because we did this very last minute, but we knew we wanted to get somebody on to help kind of come in as a guest for this. We had a great time with Ken last time. So I talked to Ken yesterday morning and said, you know, are there any topics you want to talk about? Oh, I'm so sorry. There is one quick little piece of news I do want to address. We're not announcing Coolio's death again on air live like we did last time, live to tape. I'm fascinated right now with my favorite pieces of interviews, which are Patti LuPone talking about shooting Agatha Coven of Chaos in Atlanta for Marvel. This is the TV series sequel, spinoff, we'll call it, to WandaVision, which was still probably my favorite Marvel TV property, tied with Loki. I'll put them kind of like side Loki by more. Side. They're both great.
I think I would put WandaVision just ahead of Loki for me, but they're
very close. And depending on the day, I'll go and listen to that theme song, that score from Loki, and just get super jazzed up for that as well. So I love both, but WandaVision was just kind of tailor made for me as a TV nerd. But Patti LuPone is one of the cast members in it. We're going to have Catherine Hahn is coming back as Agatha. Aubrey Plaza's in it. Who else? Deborah Jo Rupp, who was in WandaVision from That 70s Show. Sasheer Zamata from SNL. A bunch of people. But Patti LuPone, you know, this is not someone that is used to the Marvel Cinematic Universe or any of these things, and someone who does not mince words or whatever. So she's just on talk shows. She's just like, it's wild. It's this crazy thing. I'm doing this thing in Atlanta. I don't know how much I can say, but she did spill the beans that it is very much going to be following in the vein of WandaVision. And it is a musical. And there are quite a few musical numbers in it, which now makes sense why they hire someone like Patti LuPone
for it.
Yeah,
why you cast Patti LuPone,
But 100%. I will say, to say my curiosity and interest is peaked would be selling it short. Every little piece of information I see from her, and also just her, like, kind of amazement at being involved in this and be like, I don't know what this thing is I'm doing down there, but it's kind of interesting and I'm along for the ride and it's fun. We there's like six witches and we're all doing this stuff. And like, I'm sure Marvel is like, I guess this is one thing that maybe like can't be ruined. It's sort of spoiler proof in terms of, you know, it's not greater MCU like tied in canon. So like, yeah, go let Patti LuPone get a whole brand new audience for us. Like,
you mean there's no toxic fanboys that are going to like attack Patti LuPone? Yeah.
I mean, yeah, they hate Brie Larson, but they're okay with Patti LuPone. But yeah, I'm super excited.
I think it sounds amazing. I should check that out. It's interesting because she was on, she played a witch on Penny Dreadful, I think, really underrated Showtime series, which, you know, the last couple seasons or whatever, I didn't like as much as the first, but I thought it was really good. Her being on it as one of the witches was pretty neat. So
I'm super excited.
Also, Simon Russell Beale was on that.
Ah, there we go. And we will. There will probably be, by the way, an entire podcast that'll be. I hazard to say it might be the three of us because it could get a little volatile with Nick. But one of the things Ken and I loved doing back in the day, many, 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 many years ago in the early aughts,
this could be anything.
We were really into fan casting the Harry Potter movies as they were happening. So we would get books that hadn't come out and been cast yet. We really wanted to fan cast. And now there is a new TV series. So we have a whole new set of British actors that we can use to cast our Harry Potter. And I would love to spend an entire episode fan casting that series and really going for it. But I
Nick will skip that one.
No offense to Nick. Nick, I love you, and I definitely will. I just think that might be a little too soon for it, but I would love to fan cast it. All right. So when I talked to Ken about topics, Ken, it was kind of interesting. The first thing he said is, you know, we're coming up on anniversaries of a lot of movies, and this happens in, you know, we're at that age where we're going to be coming up on the 20th anniversary of this and the 25th anniversary of this and the 30th anniversary of this. And we previously in the podcast did Party Like It's 1999, because 99 was such a huge year in movies. And I said, well, right now we are 25 years past 1998. In 1998, it was kind of interesting as we were talking about this, I pulled up my phone and I started looking at movies in 1998. And part of the discussion I want to have, and Ben, we didn't talk about this ahead of time because I kind of wanted to get your take. But 98 is a really interesting year in film, and that 99 feels very much like the ushering into the 2000s. It is really the start of the 2000s and what movies were going to be in that. Whereas 98 was this.
Hold fast. I think The Matrix was like, that was the first movie of the 2000s, even though it came out in April of 1999.
100%, because it was also the first like tech movie that wasn't like taught like hackers or like felt immediately dated. It was tech that all of a sudden felt like this is something different.
I think the Sandra Bullock vehicle, The Net, could have come out yesterday and it would have felt contemporary.
Only because of Dennis Miller.
I watch Demolition Man and I'm like, this is like looking into a mirror.
It is eerie how much of Demolition Man has come true.
Really predictive.
Although, I mean, to be fair, Dennis Leary's rant in that does sound like some Reddit
actually,
shit.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, actually, like the veganism and, you know, what's the
rat
line?
Burger.
It's a 40-year-old.
I want to smoke three packs of cigarettes and eat a fucking burger because I can't.
I've seen the future. It's a 45-year-old virgin, like eating, what is it? Like eating tofu and singing, I'm an Oscar Mayer wiener. Like,
that's like that. Fantastic. Good stuff. So yeah, so 98 as kind of counter programming to 99 was almost this last of a decade, but also not really feeling like the 90s necessarily either. There's a lot of these weird little pockets of things that happened in 98 in films that are kind of like exist only in that year. Like they were the last of some things, they were the first of other things. It's a really interesting year in film.
Yeah,
it was the best of times. It was the worst of times.
I have to ask you, Ben. So as I posed this to Ben, was like, I love this idea. And then he set up a joke and I couldn't tell which way he was going to go with the joke. Cause he goes, I'm so excited. And then he just went ... And I filled in, Can't Hardly Wait, which I assumed was the 98 film he was going for. But what was the one you actually were going for?
I said, I love it. And I was like, actually, I Shakespeare and love it.
I spent a good 2 minutes being like, oh, it's got to be, it's Can't Hardly Wait. Can't Hardly Wait. And then yeah, Shakespeare and Love It was much better. But yeah, so... Let's kind of first of all, we are all somewhat different ages. We are literally, I think, actually in order, like Ben youngest, Ken, and then me. So where were you both in 1998? Where does this year in movies fall in your life?
That's so funny. Well, you want me to go ahead, mm-hmm. Ken? Well, yeah. So the irony is like 1998, I remember very clearly because it was in between. Well, that was the end of my freshman year of high school and my sophomore year of high school, the summer in between being relatively eventful for me, just because like I had my first like girlfriend and first like love. She was 2 years older than me, so she could drive me around.
Well done.
Dropping that great. V card.
And she was a preacher. She was a Episcopal priest's daughter. So
yeah,
kinky.
You know that they're freaky. I was just like, I was obsessed. I had become obsessed with movies, and obviously, I was always obsessed with movies. But I was really getting into like a lot of like independent film and a bunch of stuff. And so I would drag her to the movies a lot. She was like, it's so funny because she could drive. She had a minivan, so she would just like come and pick me up, and we went to the movies a lot that year. So we saw a lot of stuff. That was also just a weird transitional year for me, just to, because I was kind of like, I felt like ninth grade was just a continuation of middle school for me. And I, whereas like my sophomore year, I actually kind of enjoyed high school. So it was definitely like I transitioned into more, less of a boy and more of like a kid, you know, more of like a dude, a young dude, a real teenager. But my taste changed a lot those years too, just based off of the movies I was seeing and based off the fact I was seeing it with somebody and like constantly like, because I realized real fast that it was like that first, you know, the first relationship that you have where she was, you know, I'm like, oh, that movie fucking sucked. And she's like, I liked it. You know, I'm like,
and you have to backpedal real quick.
You Got Mail is the worst movie of the year. No, yeah, we saw, like, I remember seeing You Got Mail and and then there were some movies like, I mean, I can't tell you how, I mean, the screening of H2O, Halloween H2O was life changing for me just because it was the first time I ever like got action in a theater.
Nice.
Hey, yeah, nice. Well done.
Outerwear. So important. So important.
and nothing like Michael Myers to get you going.
I worked with a guy who was a bit player in Halloween H2O. That was his big claim to fame.
That's cool.
Paul Rudd did that movie, correct? Yeah.
Paul Rudd was in that movie.
Paul Rudd is in Halloween H2O. Yeah.
I would not go searching for it. it's pretty bad. From what I remember, I cannot say I've revisited Halloween H2O, but I remember like that's the, you know, the movie's bad when you'll like be getting a fucking hand job and you're like, this movie's bad.
Yeah. For me, that was, well, man, should I like even Rock of Ages? That was like much more recent.
I would love for that to be like a scene in a fucking movie, just being in the theater, seeing Rock of Ages and like getting some sort of like sexual favor.
Oh, it was terrible. It was terrible. Yeah. But you know, any port in a storm. That's really interesting. Yeah, like
is it better? Experience. Yeah, is it better to be engaging in that activity that's pulling you away from a good movie or a bad movie? Mine was during Alexander, which gave me lots of time. I'm pretty sure that was a five-peat. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing is like if you weren't particularly into what was going on, you could stare at Angelina Jolie for a little bit.
Well, it was also the movie takes Dawson. For God. There is a great Rosario. I'm pretty sure that sped things up. I was like, no, wait, let's do that again. We've got 7 more hours of this movie to take place, but that's terrible. It's like the Seinfeld where he makes out during Schindler's List.
Oh yeah.
Or the English Patient. Ken, where were you in 98?
I was a junior in high school, and as Matt knows, Ben, did you grow up in Florida, Ben?
No, I grew up in Tennessee.
Oh, okay. Wow. So like in Florida, if you don't like the beach, then it's just movies or the mall. Right. And, you know, I was definitely a movie and mall kid. And, you know, so in looking at these movies in 98, a whole bunch of them, I know I never saw in theaters, you know, like the stuff that I came to later. But there were definitely some theater experiences here, like Something About Mary, or, you know, where I think like I missed half the movie, you know, had to go back. I think it might have been the first movie I went back to see, you know, and there's like a bunch of these in there. For me, this was a year where, like Matt was alluding to it before, where I kind of became aware of kind of some indie stuff and like these weird little like kind of outliers and like pockets of things that like randomly I found myself, you know, watching and like enjoying and being like, oh, well, that's interesting. Like being aware of directors kind of for the first time.
Yeah.
I would say happened in this year. And there's some really interesting stuff going on with that as well. But I think it's like Aronofsky's debut, right? Mm-hmm. Is in 98.
Yeah, Pi was in 98. Yep.
And there's a few of those. It also gave me, I will say this, the best theater experience of my life. Second, maybe only to yours, Ben. Where I got to see Armageddon in a packed New York City theater, like on its opening weekend, and it was the most fun I've ever had in a movie theater. I mean, people were losing their shit. It was so much fun. So great. Great, great crowd. And you didn't always get those in, you know, no. in Florida. Like in Florida, usually what you get is like me and my friends going to see Contact, and then like octogenarians behind you are like, that's the key to the movie right there. Like at the most, like at points that have nothing to do with the plot.
Oh,
you
know? It's her father.
It's her father. He's alive.
Oh,
Janet, he's alive. I mean,
was her father an alien the whole time?
The whole time, of course.
Edith. Oh, I do. I have shared this on the podcast before, but I Ken has not heard this one. But one of my favorite South Florida theater going experiences was going to see The Wolf of Wall Street, the scene where Margot Robbie comes out fully nude. This woman behind me just goes, "Oh my god!" Like it just lost her. She's like. And I was like, we're all thinking it, but exactly. She put voice Lady, to it, gave voice to it. But that's one of my favorite things I've ever seen. So, and then so someone great. The other day shared a almost identical story on like a Twitter thing, basically saying that when they went to go see Dangerous Liaisons and Uma Thurman took her top off, some old lady did the same thing behind her. She's like, oh my God. That's amazing.
Also, they also had the same reaction in The Crying Game.
In a very different, that's the South Beach reaction. It's the Harvey Weinstein. Yeah. oh my God.
And by the
God.
Way, he's, well, yeah, Harvey Firestein.
What did I say? Weinstein? Oh, shit. Yeah, that's a terrible Weinstein. That's a terrible
and by the
slip
way,
up.
This is the year of Weinstein.
Yes. It is. This is the very famous. We will get to that.
All over. All over this
big,
year.
Big win. Big win year for Miramax.
Well, and it's what's kind of interesting also about this time is, you know, going back to that year, it was also, there were a lot of things that happened at the very end of 97. That, you know, when Ken, when you talk about some of these movies, you like movies you haven't seen in the theater, you would catch later on. There were a lot of things that you were catching that were, you know, like Boogie Nights was something I didn't see until 98. And like some other movies that I kind of caught. I didn't catch Chasing Amy until 98. Right. Mm-hmm. So that was like a big year for me. Same as both of you guys, by the way. That was where directors really popped up in my consciousness. So I'm a couple years older than you guys. So this was my... the second half of my freshman year in college. So from you know, January to June, I was at Ohio State, and then I transferred, and then because I was transferring, I had to do a semester at PBCC. So that's where I was down here for the rest, like the second half of 98, it was down in Florida. And that was the same thing again, like I didn't want to go to the beach. So I would go to like classes, and then in between, and I didn't want to go home either. I was like back with my parents and I didn't want to be there. So I went and watched movie after movie at the Jupiter movie theater. At Jupiter back then, Regal? I think it was 14. It used to be Jupiter 8 when I first moved to Florida, then it became 14. They had just gotten stadium seating at one point. But I remember going to see Saving Private Ryan a second time, but I couldn't make it past Wade's scene. It was the one scene in the movie it was so upsetting to me. Wade's death, Giovanni Ribisi's death.
Oh yeah,
and hit me so hard that I went and watched the movie, and I had to walk out like at that scene the second time seeing it, and I couldn't handle it. I probably went to that movie maybe three or four times to eventually get back through it again. But go ahead.
No. I was saying, well, no,
we'll get into that. But, back to it. But yeah, it was so, you know, so half of that year I'm up at college and I'm seeing things for the first time. I wound up seeing Armageddon down in Jupiter here in Florida. But the one I saw at Ohio State was Deep Impact, which is the far inferior and terrible asteroid movie of that year. No, I fucking hate it. John Favreau and Ron Eldard are the only good things about that movie. Maybe Elijah Wood, but it's a terrible movie. It's a god-awful, terrible movie.
It's a tougher, you know, movie. It's more, I mean, neither of these is, like, realistic.
No.
But, I mean, but Armageddon is, like...
It's fun! It's fucking fun! Deep Impact is fucking the worst parts of the asteroid.
Deep Impact takes itself way too seriously. But I always, first of all... Maybe
that's Mimi Leader, right?
I know it's probably... I know it's idiosyncratic, but I do love, like, human Noah's Ark movies. You know, like, when there's just a few human survivors and, like, kind of projecting and being like, okay, well, what is this going to look like?
Yeah,
I mean,
me too,
it hits, it's supposed to hit.
Yeah, yeah. Like that's what actually one of the reasons why I kind of like still like Terminator 3, as I'm just like,
oh, I like that movie.
It's like it's like actually kind of cool at the end because they're like, no, we don't.
Yeah.
We're not putting off the apocalypse. The apocalypse fucking happens.
Actually, there's like, no way to stop it. And everything that came before is just like that. Humans spinning their wheels. The ending of, absolutely couldn't agree with you more. The ending of Terminator 3 is one of the most underrated, most mature endings of a film franchise. That was supposed to be.
That whole movie is actually pretty damn good. I mean, like, it's not a bad movie.
No, I have to rewatch it.
I will tell you this, Ken. I can speak for you on this. What's so funny about this is, Ben, you and I have talked about this in more recent years at some point. But Ken, you and I talked about Terminator 3 at length when that movie came out, and we talked about exactly what Ben just said, which is these are worlds colliding for me because these are separate conversations. But we were really big on Terminator 3. The ending was great. We loved the bit of him trying to like program himself to be more human and being cheesy and silly about it. And we're like, this, all of this works, but the ending especially is just so effective of like seeing that, like all the nukes just like the going ICBMs, off, and you're just like, I couldn't do it. I couldn't stop it
while they're doing it. Yeah. It's a harrowing thing.
And the other crazy part is that it has this thing that's built in that a lot of people didn't even reference, which is the fact that like when Claire Danes realizes that who Nick Stahl's character actually is, and she's like, well, I forgot the name of the characters, but she's like, you were in that guy's basement and we made out or whatever. And it was like the universe, no matter what was happening, was going to pull them back together somehow. Like it was inevitable. It was going to happen one way or the other. And it does give you that sort of fate thing that it throws in there of just like, no, it doesn't matter. Like that Stephen King wrote about in like 11.
1122.
Or the same thing as in Replay, which is one of my favorite books, Ken Follett book. But like it's this idea that like no matter what you can try to do to change the future, there are so many forces that are pulling it in this one singular direction on this one timeline that it's almost impossible to pull away from it. So no matter what, they were going to end up together. And the fact is that even though they changed the future, they still ended up together.
Yeah.
You know, and then like the same thing ended up happening. And I was just like, I fucking love that. It's such a cool concept. It's just like, it's such a heady thing. And nobody even mentioned that part of it. Like when they were criticizing T3 about whatever sort of the design of the T-8000 or whatever, I forgot the name of the actor, the
Christina
woman.
Christina Locken.
Yeah, exactly. But that design was
Terminatrix.
Totally cool. Yeah, the Terminatrix. But which she was never said. Terminatrix is never said the movie. No. It's somebody just coined that. She's just a model.
Someone's
got
to gender it and stuff like that. Yeah. I completely agree.
Fucking cool. Cool movie. Anyways, sorry to go on the so that
we will cover this more on our Terminator 3 related podcast. That's our spin-off of the new way, the Terminatrix podcast. We will definitely cover that.
I was gonna say the thing that I was looping back around is that one of the things we had already gotten to in 98 was the film Property Wars, which is where you have two of the same kind of movie, and it's like this huge rush to see who can get it out first. And really the thing that kicked that kind of whole thing off, a lot of people will say Independence Day, because Independence Day was this huge summer blockbuster movie where they were like, okay, well, if we're going to try and make an event film, but there were already these other event films that were sort of already in progress, like Twister, things that were around these types of disasters. Okay, well, we're going to make our volcano movie. Well, Warner's is making a volcano movie, and also, you know, New Line or whoever is making their volcano movie. So we have two volcano movies that come out within a month and a half of one another already in pre-pro, your asteroid movies and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Your very high profile war movies, World War II movies by, you know, A-list heralded directors. And it was just like the studios all of a sudden just started throwing money at events. And it was just this rat race to see who could get him out fast enough. And 1998 was the pinnacle of it, because you had Thin Red Line and Saving Private Ryan very famously on the heralded side. And then you had Armageddon and Deep Impact as the really terrible movies that made money.
Great point. And it's, you know, and sometimes they were like, you know, neck and neck in terms of the release date. I think Thin Red Line came out in December, if I'm reading my notes correctly. So that was like skin of its teeth. But yeah. I don't think Terrence Malick, you know, I mean, I'm sure I'm not surprised.
Well, the studio, I mean, like, they were up against one another for every single major film award outside of the Oscars into the Oscars. I mean, it was 100%. that was the whole question was like, what's going to win Best Picture? Is it going to be The Thin Red Line or is it going to be Saving Private Ryan?
And is Spielberg going to get like director and like, you know, that kind of stuff, which was always like part of the narrative. There's also not to like, I mean, it's a very brief tangent, I promise, but HBO films, they had Pentagon Wars, Bright Shining Lie, When Trumpets Fade, three big time, like kind of war movies when HBO was doing like, you know, really starting to kick off like their own
original content.
Yeah. Their original content. Exactly. And in fact, their best one or their highest acclaimed, I think, that year was Gia, the Angelina Jolie model movie, you know, like based on like the 80s model or whatever.
Well, and you had and they came out in slightly separate years, but they were in the same time. That was also the same. This is the year that Bug's Life came out, then Ants. And Ants was not 98.
Those were the ones I was leaving out.
100%.
The high profile animated film with the very, very different plots, but still the same device of it being bugs.
But sure. Very, you know, different. Like,
generated.
What I do like about those ones, I really appreciate those. And I mean, you can say the same for Thin Red Line and Saving Private Ryan in terms of very different films. But Ants and Bug's Life are like categorically, like, one is a dystopian, almost kind of fascist. Like thing, and the other is just a Pixar movie about, you know, like coming together, and it's a remake of the Magnificent Seven or whichever property from that thing, which we've covered that on the podcast on an episode before.
Speaking of that, real quick, about like you know, Seven Samurai and, you know, that kind of stuff, Akira Kurosawa died in this year.
Really?
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Interesting.
I did this. This was going to be my little, like, kind of, like, into 1998. The deaths, the notable deaths this year, celebrity, like, or performers, Henny Youngman, J.T. Walsh, who had a pretty large role in one of my favorite 98 movies, Lloyd Bridges, Frank Sinatra, Akira Kurosawa, and Phil Hartman.
Wow.
Yikes.
All in 98. And then, just to make us feel extra old, here are the births. Elle Fanning, Maya Hawke, Jaden Smith, and Aaron Kellyman, all born in 98.
Wow. There's some good that's some good trivia there. JT Walsh.
Such a fan. Oh my god.
I mean, there are two, he's in two movies I remember very well from 98. It's so weird. Like, this is a really hard one for me, and one of the reasons I had trouble kind of prepping for it is that I literally watched so many movies in the theater in 98, and I, like, not so just good movies, but like J.T. Walsh was in The Negotiator as well as Pleasantville. Mm-hmm. I saw both of those movies in the movie theater that year.
Yeah, of course.
And I also, like, this was also because I was back down here. This is when I kind of, my friendship with Ken kicked off kind of in full, because he was finishing up high school. His brother was finishing like in high school. So I had a bunch of these like high school kids that I would hang out with on the weekends, and we would go see, and so like there were like girls and else. So I'm like, I saw Ever After in the theater this year. And I saw a ridiculous amount of movies. I don't think there's any year I've seen more movies in the theater than 1998.
That's awesome. I told my wife the topic of the podcast, and she was like, well, Ever After came out in 1998. Yeah. Literally the first thing that she said, she was like, that was a big movie for teenage girls.
That was a huge movie.
I am not going to lie. I fucking love the shit out of that movie. And
is it Dougray Scott? Who's one?
It is Dougray Scott and Melanie Linsky. That was my introduction to Melanie Linsky.
Melanie Linsky's one of the sisters, right?
Yep.
It's a very clever movie, and it's absolutely like, it's clever, and it's really well done. And the performances, I mean, they're all good performers, you know, so like, I shouldn't be surprised. But yeah, great.
Film. It was a movie I went to, like, and there were a lot of movies I went to this year. This was the year I did watch Phantoms at someone's house. the Ben Affleck, based on a Dean Koontz novel.
The bomb in Phantoms.
It was just a terrible fucking movie. I remember that was I was not invited back to someone's house that year because they a bunch of us, like 20 of us, went over to this girl's house to, and they put on Phantoms, and I could not hold back, and I was just ripping on it the entire time, and half the people found it very entertaining, and the other half were not having it.
I kind of want to loop around to some of the bigger, kind of more event things here in a second, but that does remind me of a very funny experience I had, because I rode crew when I was in high school, in middle and high school, and I remember we had a crew party, like a sleepover one night. We all went to somebody's house, and we had pizza, and we were like, you know, it was like a Friday night or whatever. And I still remember we went to Blockbuster on the way, and everyone was like, Ben likes movies. Let Ben pick a movie or whatever, because they knew I was like the movie nerd. And so I still remember the two movies that we watched, because it was that fall, where
Blackboard Jungle.
We watched, it had just come out in video. We watched There's Something About Mary, because everybody went, there were like a few people still hadn't seen it at that point, and everyone thought it was funny. And
I rented
I rented Rushmore.
Yes.
And I still remember everybody fucking hated me.
What?
Like, nobody liked the movie except for one of my best friends, Annie. And we're sitting there cracking up. I haven't seen the movie yet. And so we're sitting there like laughing our asses off watching Rushmore. And everyone else is like, this movie sucks. And then they just left. Like they left the room.
That's a litmus test for like humanity.
That's the thing. It's like, I personally know, still know some of the people who were in that room who would now protest heavily that but I was like, I was there. I saw you guys walk out, pretend like Rushmore. And there's always strength in numbers too.
But like, you're young, like you would have been what, 15, 14?
Yeah,
like
15.
I mean, I don't know. Fuck it. No. Like when I was 15, I mean, I was 13 and I thought Pulp Fiction was the most amazing thing I'd ever seen in my fucking life.
Well, and I
saw Pulp Fiction at a crew party.
I saw Pulp Fiction in the theater and the projector broke and burned up the film in the middle of it. And we all thought it was part of the movie. And we're like, this guy is brilliant. And they're like, no, the movie's broken, kids. You're going to have to wait 10 minutes to fix it. So I will say what's really funny. One of the things I put in my notes, I completely associate Rushmore with Ken. Because Ken was the first person to show that movie to me. I did not see it in theater, but you guys either knew of it or wanted to rent it because of Bill Murray, and you'd heard like good buzz about it, and Brian Cox, like there's so many like little hidden gems in that movie. But I remember watching that at the house in Frenchman's Creek, Jonathan's Landing. Where were you?
We lived.
Yeah, were.
Crystal Point.
With
an E on the end of
right in the midst of all of those other neighborhoods.
That's how you know it's fancy when there's an E at the end of Point.
It's one of those there's a million communities.
Ye oldie discount.
Florida, like.
when there's an E on the end of Point, it is not rent controlled.
That's cool. No, I remember I watched many a movie at that house well as going to the theater from 98 to 2004, pretty much. I watched almost everything there. But you guys introduced me to Rushmore for the first time, amongst other. I also saw Wet Hot the first time there. I saw Super Troopers the first time there. You guys introduced me to some fucking phenomenally good movies.
You're welcome.
But Rushmore is still like, I love Royal Tenenbaums a lot, and it's always a hard decision for me. But just from the introduction to Wes Anderson, because even though Bottle Rocket came out before that, I didn't see Bottle Rocket first.
Yeah,
I saw Rushmore,
exactly.
And that is what, like, I'm like, who is this filmmaker? Yeah. And the style of this movie is so compelling. And it's go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
No. You look at something like, you know, Licorice Pizza, which all of us have kind of talked about being a fundamentally flawed film that has maybe some great performances in it, but doesn't really necessarily need to exist, and you can kind of understand why it exists.
That's your perspective. I love Licorice
Pizza. I have issues with Licorice Pizza, but I think Rushmore is something with an equally problematic, somewhat problematic plotting to it, or some difficult plotting to it. I guess when you talk about kind of, you have a love triangle between a child and a man and a woman, but it's really handled much more compassionately, I guess, for me.
But also, it's not, you know, it's not reciprocated. Not that this is Rushmore podcast, but she never entertains a relationship with Max, right? Like, he's always, you know, their relationship evolves, but it's never romantic, at least not from what I remember. But yeah, like Rushmore, I mean, it's another great example of us becoming aware when we're younger of a director and being like, being able to recognize a director and be like, wow, this, you know, this person's fingerprints are all over this. This is a Wes Anderson. This is a,
and then you would seek out whatever their new thing was going to be, like that, which is what we all do now much more extensively. But back then I didn't care about, like, I knew who Spielberg was and I would watch a Spielberg movie. But other than that, I didn't know shit.
100%, 100%. But 98 is full of these, you know, like there's a bunch of those. But I mean, Rushmore was absolutely a seminal work.
Yeah, 100%. The other thing I thought was good to also touch on as far as it being a big year is people don't realize it because the thing that put him on the map had kind of already come out, but I do think it was kind of the year of Kevin Williamson and the year of Meta becoming really big. Because first off, we had The Faculty, which was written by Kevin Williamson, and it was the start of Dawson's Creek, which a lot of people forget that.
Wow, he fuck, that was 98. That's crazy.
So, yeah. So, and the thing is like if you look at The Faculty now. It really does have the fingerprints of a lot of the stuff that came out in the aughts, where it was very self-referential. It was very clearly like, you know, this is what the dumb character does in this situation. I mean, it has lines like that in the movie, you know?
Yeah.
And it is very playful with everything. And in the same way that he kind of did it with Scream and how big that was.
I was just going to say.
But Scream was 96 and Scream 2 was 99.
Yeah. 97? Scream 2 was 97. I kept thinking it was 98 because I saw it up at Ohio State. I remember watching up there. I thought it was 90. I think I saw it in 98 because it came out in 97, but I was...
Yeah, I knew it was 1 year off because it didn't come out that year. But I knew that Kevin Williamson, that was his big... You know, like Dawson's Creek was his big thing because he launched that series.
But, I think sorry to interrupt, Ben, but I think what you're saying is so important. It's so interesting because when you talk about films or any media becoming like self-referential, I think there's a reflection, like sort of a cultural reflection on the 90s. And it's, you know, for me, this is, and I'm kind of struck by how few like true action movies are on this list. It's like we moved off of, because before this, like it's, you know, it's all like, you know, Cold War type stuff. Like every action movie is like, you wouldn't have like an Armageddon, you know, in 1990. You have like Hunt for Red October in 91, right? Kind of a thing, like as the Soviet Union is collapsing. Here, you get like, I think one of the reasons there's such a diversity to the styles and genres that are happening in 98 is it's kind of like everyone's sort of like, well, what is America now? And like, what, you know, who are the bad guys and who are the good guys? And, you know, what is, you know, what's that journey look like? It's an interesting cultural moment where I think there is some self-reflection going on. And then, you know, 99, like you guys have talked about, like really just does launch the aughts.
Well, I mean, another thing you have to mention about 1998 is that was after the rights reversion, the very first Marvel movie.
Oh, yes.
Which was Blade.
Oh, I did not forget about that. So, like, I've got a few things on this list. One of them is absolutely Blade. Launching without it knowing the viability of the MCU,
which Matt had never seen, and I tried to show it to him because I still think Blade's a fucking great movie.
It's an awesome movie. It's a banger.
And Matt couldn't even get through it. He
I did. First of all,
he quit after 45 minutes.
We finished. We completed that movie. I completely remember. It was Thanksgiving Day. We were full on a lot of turkey, and I was very sleepy. We were also drinking a little bit. I was drinking a bit. Your garbage disposal broke, and you had to have someone come in. I remember there was a trek, so we had some stops and starts, but we did finish the movie. I cannot say that I didn't maybe possibly for like a minute here and there rest my eyes for just a bit. I missed the whole Blade thing, the same as I've missed the Underworld. I've never seen an Underworld movie. I've never seen there's a few like genre series that I never really just I got into. Blade is Blade was on in the background when I like hooked up with someone once that they had put it on, but I don't remember. I don't remember anything on the screen. It was good times. But there's some interesting things I think in 98 of kind of I feel there's a lot of voices.
I would just
being
say
found.
That all of those things are predictive factors. Is kind of what, yes. what I meant is that there were the whole meta thing. The again, Blade was a big success, a big success for New Line and who released it, and
but no one knew that it was a Marvel property. No one like right. you know. Well, I mean, some you know fanboys.
Yeah, people knew. You know, yeah, but it wasn't like, a big deal that it was a comic
not,
book.
Exactly, yeah. But that's not why it was successful, right? Which is very yeah. different, and it was R-rated. Which was different.
Yep. It was hard R. Hard R. And yeah, with Chris Christopherson. I mean, we talk about yeah, we talk about a crazy, crazy, weird movie. And Stephen then also Dorff,
Donald,
the
Donald Logue. Yep.
And directed by Stephen Norrington, who has like three feature film credits to his entire filmography. Yeah. Like he did League of Extraordinary Gentlemen and got fucking blackballed.
Yeah, that got like that. Destroyed. Was he more of a screenwriter? I feel like he's one of those screenwriters that tried directing.
He was like a commercial and music video director. Yeah, and
they can
and then
one Fincher, I guess.
Yeah, no, he was like a really big in-demand guy. But he had like I think while he was making like League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, he had like a nervous breakdown or something. Oh, same God. Thing. I think the same thing that happened to the dude who directed Con Air. Basically, it was like
he said it
was Michael Bay.
Well, he said, Simon West.
He said that during League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, during which he had such a hard time with Sean Connery, the film star, that he announced he would never direct another film. He later changed his mind, though, as of 2022, has yet to do so. which is kind of fucking crazy. Like Connery broke him. Like, he did something bad to him.
Yeah, something happened.
And that was like Connery after he turned down Lord of the Rings. So,
well, I mean, Simon West, same thing happened with Simon West, who because he directed Con Air. But when he was making the H.G. Wells Time Machine remake or whatever,
with Guy
apparently
Pierce,
like he had a nervous breakdown while he was directing it and just never directed another movie.
Yeah, there's a lot of
that's crazy.
There's a lot of tragedies.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
Well, I think so one of the things I think is interesting about this year in films, because you have a lot of these like launches of, you know, you have launches of some of these directors, and oftentimes it's not even their first film, but it's their first kind of major movie. But I think it's also, sadly, there's a peak for some actors and directors in this time that hit an apex that they've never really been able to reach again. So you look at like There's Something About Mary, and I say this as a gigantic fan of Me, Myself, and Irene. I think it is one of the most underrated fucking hysterical movies. But the Farrelly brothers never met Something About Mary quite like that was their peak.
Not in terms of a commercial success, but critically, yes. Green Book.
Yes, sure. But that's only one of them.
Oh, I completely agree. Like, it's one Farrelly. Yeah. It's also, like, it's not a straight comedy. It's, you know, its own thing. It's also, like, kind of a white apology.
Well, now he's turned into, like, a McKay. Like, he did his McKay kind of move and went to serious stuff. But really, you see that peak there. But you also see what's really interesting one to me, like, looking back on this, was this was also peak Adam Sandler. You have The Waterboy and Wedding Singer in the same year.
Can I give you what the real apex mountain of 1998 is?
Yeah.
I'm stealing that from a different podcast, but the real apex here, this is the year of Gwyneth.
Very much.
This is
her Oscar year.
She was in Shakespeare in Love, obviously.
She was. Here's the in
Sliding
order,
Doors.
Great Expectations. A Perfect Murder. And of course, Shakespeare in Love, which comes out last. And that's like Miramax's big push. But I mean, I didn't even see Great Expectations, but I knew about it because like the poster, you know, like, I mean, it's
Alfonso Cuarón's Great Expectations. And man, that's a saucy movie.
This is an insane year for Gwyneth Paltrow. She basically comes out of like she's an like you know Nepo baby, right? Bruce Paltrow and Blythe Danner like have this
Blythe
like,
Danner.
Like, you don't have Gwyneth today. You don't have Pepper Potts Gwyneth. You don't have Goop without 98. This is like this is the year of Gwyneth. There's a constellation.
So that is the quote. If we had a video cassette at Blockbuster that had a quote from the movie on it, it would be you don't have Goop without 1998.
So the next time you are taking a bath and enjoying your vagina candle,
yeah,
that's
just
right.
Remember, you owe that when to 1998.
You owe, if you're enjoying that jade ball roller over your shoulder, it's because of 98. It's because of 98, friend.
98.
It's funny, and Ben that year had a similar goop experience in the movie theater while he was watching that movie. So it all ties together.
You know how we were talking about how destiny just finds a way? I mean, yeah. That's
yeah.
It's the year of Gwyneth. It just everything aligned.
So,
it's like, but did everything align, or was it Weinstein like making this ingenue like a thing? Like, I mean, this is this is a lot of work. You know, a lot of PR.
So, Great Expectations was Miramax, and Shakespeare in Love was Miramax. Was Sliding Doors also Miramax?
I don't know.
Sounds like it is to me. I could be wrong about that. But what's also interesting about this is now we know, kind of in retrospect of what we've heard about Weinstein and everything on there, is that he was trying to do the same shit with Gwyneth, and the only reason he didn't quite get there was Brad Pitt stepping in and being like, I'm the only person that's bigger than you from a box office standpoint at this point to be able to stand up to you and be like, fucking back off of her. And like, and that's kind of crazy. Like the idea that she still succeeds. I mean, obviously you can tell what Harvey wanted to be doing with her during this time and building that up. And then you also watch that kind of fall off a little bit after this peak year for her, where he's been told like, yeah, you're not going to be able to fuck her. You need to like move on and go find someone else's career to ruin.
That stuff is so fucked up. Like,
Brad Pitt's got his own problems, but I will say anybody that was strong, like big enough at that point to be like the one person that stood up to Harvey Weinstein was like, fuck you. Like, no, like I'm worth more than you.
Sorry to like, I mean, this is a non sequitur. I'm just looking at the domestic box office for 98. But when did Titanic come out? Was it 97?
97. And then, it was still running at number one all the way for like 14 weeks into 98.
It came out on my birthday in 97.
It's the number one movie of 98.
Still. Yeah.
It came out in 97, still the number one movie in 98.
It had the most repeat box office of any film. And it for like month to month to month to month on there. Now,
by the way, Matt, Deep Impact was number 7 in 98, so time will tell on this one, all right? will tell.
I'm going to play you guys a little game here, because I find this kind of interesting. And I don't know if you guys might on your list have this pulled up, I don't know, but if you do, then you have to bow out. But I have a list on IMDb of films released in 1998 by popularity on IMDb. And the top 10 is not necessarily there's one that is number 3 in the top 10 of 1998 that I would not it was nowhere near any list I was looking at whatsoever. But
I will look at my list.
One has to be Can't Hardly Wait, though, right?
Not in the top 10.
It's not in the
Can't
top,
Hardly like, Wait I, is I actually it's still kind of, no. There's
kind of, that movie is still good.
There are some amazing movies on this popular list. The popular list is great.
Can't Hardly Wait as a junior and being like, man, I should be seeing this as a senior. I felt like robbed that I couldn't be like graduating in 98. I should be like, you know, a senior watching this movie. I got to go back to high school after watching this awesome like leaving high school movie.
I saw this was after I left high school. And I remember I ran into someone from our high school. I won't say any names on here. Not that this person would ever be listening to the podcast, but someone I didn't particularly like from my class. And I ran into them at the movie theater and they were like, oh, I just saw Can't Hardly Wait. It was cute, but predictable. And I was just like, what fucking get over. Like, I'll tell you afterwards. It'll make perfect sense to you.
You can text it to me now.
I'll get to there in just a second. But
is Phantoms number 2?
No. What do you think is the number one most popular movie on IMDb from 1998? This is current popularity as of 2023. So IMDb is constantly fluctuating because there are people finding movies after the fact.
I haven't looked at this list, but I do have my list of like all of like you know, movies in order that came out in 98 that I did. I'm going to guess either Truman Show or How Stella Got Her Groove Back. No, I'm just kidding. Not that one. Or
There's so many movies that I love. Like, Waking Ned Divine is so great. Ronin is an awesome fucking movie.
Ken, do you think Waking Ned Divine is the most popular movie from 1998 on IMDb?
I have one weird guess
to talk about, but
yeah.
I won't.
Go for it, Ben.
It's not the most popular, but it's on the list. Is Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas one of them?
It is in the top
10.
25. Yeah. But it is not. So number one. All right. So I'm going to give you some hints. Number one is by an established. This is hard to without completely giving away. But the established filmmakers.
Plural.
Yeah, Lebowski. I do love that. Basketball was a guest on there. That could have been, but Lebowski is the most popular movie on IMDb from 98.
That's amazing because it was excoriated like when it came out. Like,
it was no one watched that movie in 98. They watched it at the end of 98 when it was on video, and like that was the earliest they were going to see it. And it really didn't take off until 99. Like, that's a movie that doesn't feel like 98.
100%.
But so this top 10 is interesting. Number two is by a very, maybe the most famous film director of all time. And
Spielberg,
Saving Private Ryan. Sure. Number three, I need to see if I can. I don't even know where. It's directed by Nancy Myers. I did not know that they directed this.
You've Got Mail.
No.
Oh.
Oh no! You Got Mail is like not even remotely on popularity of this. Directed in 98 by Nancy Myers. Notable people in the cast: Dennis Quaid. Natasha Richardson?
What?
Lindsay Lohan? The Parent Trap is the third most popular movie from 1998.
Yeah, okay.
Crazy.
That's not. Then your guess, Ken, number four, Truman Show, phenomenally great movie. So rounding out our top 10, American History X at 5. Mm-hmm. I don't know how the fuck this is at number 6. I can't even. I saw this movie in the theater. I think possibly to watch the Phantom Menace trailer that appeared before it. Meet Joe Black is number 6 for 1998.
This is bullshit. There's no
people
way
in that movie wouldn't rate it number 6 of the year. The person that wrote that movie
have tried to scrub it from their resume.
I can't understand it. One that I hadn't. So this is an interesting one. And when we talk about directors kind of hitting their like popularity or starting off points, Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels.
Oh yeah,
that's number 7.
Yep. That's huge.
Blade is number 8. Bug's Life 9 and Thin Red Line number 10. There's a movie. So there's a movie that I saw this year, and I know we are jumping all over the place on this. But when you talk about those theater going experiences, they're super fun. One of the most fun times I've had in the theater. This was up in Ohio State. It was right before I came back down. I went with the cast of Bye Bye Birdie that I was in at that time, and we went to the movie theater to see Wild Things. I don't know that I've had a more fun time in a packed theater, just like everyone losing their shit, especially at the end, like the whole ending sequence where everyone's like, what the fuck is this? This is amazing.
I'm sure that that's true, first of all. And secondly, this was on my list for the last gasp of the 90s. Mm. This is such a 90s movie.
90s, yeah.
I mean, like, it is, like, there's so much gratuity in it, like, of all kinds.
It's funny because it's also one of those movies that it's not quite a parody. It's more, it's kind of a lampoon of 80s. It's, you know, like Body Heat. Kind of
self-aware, like what Ben was talking about.
Yes, very much. I think you're hit on something, Ben, of like, this is the birth of really understanding the mind, like the intricacies of meta. Like, because Wild Things is a tabloid movie.
It's like let's Skinamax you know, kind of this noir plot.
Let's do our Tarantino, Elmore Leonard, Skinamax movie, but it's going to be clever, and we're going to cast it really fucking well, so that the cleverness is actually comes across, and it doesn't feel whatever.
Sorry, not bad for Matt Dillon in 98, huh? He had a couple some good stuff going on.
And his work in There's Something About Mary.
Still cashing those 98
checks. His work in Something About Mary is so fucking good.
The scene where he first meets Ted, and he like stands up and he like buckles his belt, like his pants were open apparently. Like no one told him to do that, not in the script, just trying it out.
He also has my single favorite moment in that movie is when he's eavesdropping on them having the conversation, and she mentions something about like maybe he has a huge dick, and he goes and he has this huge laugh that they all like turn to look, and he's just like no, I didn't do anything. That's one of my favorite things.
Yeah, I think the line is actually who cares, I have a vibrator.
I have a vibrator. That's correct. That is much more on the nose than I have.
Yes, absolutely. Well deserved 98 for Matt Dillon. He'd put in work in the late 80s and early 90s.
So I have a question for you, and this is a very loaded question that I have an answer to. I don't know if you guys have an answer, but I am kind of curious. What is the is there anything in 98? Because again, for me, this was my freshman year of college. So and then going into 99, where I think I actually watched this movie, but it's a movie from 98. Were there any movies or directors or things that you were introduced to that were like really off the beaten path for you that seemed like these kind of, and I don't know if we all have the same one rattling around in our head from this year, but there's one specifically on here that like opened my mind to subversive filmmaking, I guess, for lack of a better phrase. Do you guys have?
Was yours Buffalo 66?
No, oddly enough. Although I did see that in the theater after I saw Opposite of Sex, because I also had a major thing for Christina Ricci, late 90s Christina Ricci.
To the bottom of Christina Ricci.
That's right. Oof. No, so Buffalo 66 is a great one on there. Mine is not that one. I know you and I, all three of us, at separate times, have talked about this movie.
Permanent Midnight was the one for me, which was Jerry Stahl's kind of autobiography. Just because I was like that, and it's so funny, they couldn't get the rights to Alf, and they did, and it was still too close to Alf, so they created Mr. Chompers.
So great.
Which is the funniest thing of like the stand-in. And if you haven't seen that, Ken, it's Ben Stiller. Ben Stiller lost like 40 pounds to play Jerry Stahl, who was like the head writer on Alf, who was like had a
this
60
is Permanent Midnight.
Yes.
Yeah, it had a $6,000 a week heroin.
Dude, Ken,
addiction.
This is so up your alley. You have no idea. My brother got me into this movie.
I still think it's one of the best directed movies of the entire 90s, in my opinion.
You did just mention one of our favorites on there, Zero Effect, which is 99.
Yeah, I love Zero Effect.
I think
so. This
99?
Is another year of it's not just.
Oh, it is 88. Fuck, 98 is Zero Effect. Shit.
Yeah.
Is that 98 Zero Effect.
Yeah, that's
so
fucking crazy.
Because he was in Zero Effect, and obviously we have Pullman in that one, too.
Yeah.
And Something About Mary, and he was in, like, so it's a great Ben Stiller year, too.
Yeah, very good Ben Stiller year. But because Zero Effect was Kasdan, right?
And
I think that's right. Yeah.
And it's interesting, the guy who, Jerry Stahl, wrote Permanent Midnight, the screenplay, and was his passion project for Ben Stiller. Like I said, Ben Stiller lost 40 pounds to play him. The large man Ben Stiller is like that's how emaciated he is in that fucking movie.
Wild.
And it was one of Owen Wilson's first movies because he was friends with
Stiller.
Because did Anaconda come? Where Anaconda was the next year. Owen Wilson was just starting out, and it was one of Owen Wilson's first kind of major roles.
Although I think in 98 was the Haunting. Is that 98?
No, that was 99.
That's 99. Okay.
Yeah, I didn't see that on the 98 list. Yeah.
So the movie I saw that I was also part of just a fucking one of the weirdest, wildest, strangest nights I had when I was at UF with these like two. It started with like skinny dipping in a pool in Gainesville, and then weird shit I can't even mention on air, and then this movie was put on at like 3 a.m. With everyone like drunk and high and chain smoking, which was Todd Solondz's Happiness. When I described to you how impressionable I was for that movie, just in the scope of what was happening that evening in my life, which was also just eye-opening, I'd never seen a movie like that where I was laughing at such depraved dark comedy and filmmaking that made me so uncomfortable, but I was still entertained by it, and it's so gross and funny and gross at the same time. I don't know how to describe it, but that was the kind of the first time where I'm like, oh, there's a whole other side to, like, I thought like I was edgy because I knew Tarantino shit, and I'm like, no, there's Tarantino's not edgy when you look at a movie like Happiness. That's just a whole other level of storytelling that is just off the beaten path.
Or there's Very Bad Things.
This is the one that I was going to say.
Oh, God damn it, Ken. I fucking blame you for this goddamn movie.
Very Bad Things was, which I saw in theaters. I don't know how. No one was carding or anything.
I saw it in the theaters in Valdosta, Georgia.
Oh, my God. I had never seen a film like this before in my life. I mean, and what can I say? It's absolutely one of those films where, you know, the spiral just keeps spiraling, you know, and for those, I don't know who's listening, you know, to this podcast and hasn't seen this movie, but I don't know what kind of place you would want to be in to watch this movie. When you say dark comedy, this is still the benchmark in the way that Event Horizon is still my benchmark for really scaring the shit out of me type movies. But the you talk about a cast, you talk about isn't Cameron Diaz in it?
She sure is.
Oh,
sure
my is. God.
Daniel Stern, John Favreau.
And the dude, the nervous dude from Seven and yes, Saving Private Ryan.
Yes.
I can't believe this movie and has Alien come Resurrection. Up again. So this has come up on the podcast before with Ben and me, but he doesn't know the context of it, which is the fact that I fucking watched this movie with you and your brother, and I couldn't make it past the middle of the movie when the dude from Saving Private Ryan is losing his shit and about to get, I think he gets hit by a car or they're someone gets run over. I find this movie to be obnoxiously unwatchable. And I have still to this date, not ever finished that movie. And I will never probably ever finish that movie. I hate this movie so much.
This movie has given me so many, I use lines from this movie when I teach. I'm like, there's the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. See that line. Yeah. I see that line. I'm your lighthouse. I stay lit for you.
At Piven.
I just love it where the security guard guy's like, what's even getting into you guys? And he goes, drugs and alcohol. And gives him the money.
And slaps the money.
He goes, I got no problem with that.
I'm every year or so, I'm like, you know what? This is the year I'm going to go and revisit this movie and get a fresh perspective on it. I did that with Magnolia, and I kind of changed my mind a bit about Magnolia many years ago.
I changed your mind about Very Bad Things.
I remember being watching with Ben and Ken and a couple of your other friends. Everyone else in the room is loving this movie. And I'm just looking around what the fuck is it's just people yelling and panicking and yelling over them to an anxiety inducing level that I can't tolerate.
So it's so interesting because I can watch Very Bad Things. Maybe I can't watch it in this way now. But I'd like to think I could. But I what you're describing is kind of Meet the Fockers or something, where it's so cringy and it's just so.
Oh, I can watch that movie a thousand times. Yeah. The cringiness of me, Very Bad Things is peak.
So cringy, but Very Bad Things is it's very obviously it's very dark. Obviously, it's very depraved, and I don't know. It's is it directed by Peter Berg?
Peter Berg.
On the actual press junket, I remember Peter Berg was on Conan fucking Brian, when that was a new show basically, and he went on and he was just so it's been interesting what people have been saying. He's like, a lot of people don't like this movie. He was just straight up about it. He was like, a lot of people don't like this movie. And he was like, somebody once told me some people like spicy food and, you should just not like them or you should not, discredit them if they don't like spicy food because some people just they don't like it. They can't handle it. And he's like, this is a movie for people who like spicy food.
That is the most apropos of all of the comparisons for me. this is my hot ones. This is something I could never do and enjoy. And I understand other people find the challenge.
But he was straight up on his, on the actual, on fucking talk shows. He was basically just people are not going to like this movie.
I appreciate that honesty from him in that point. It is remarkable that he would even go there, when he's trying to sell tickets, right? But honestly, there's probably some people that checked it out because he was saying that.
No, totally. I mean, I think at that point it was probably they realized they looked at the numbers and they were like, this movie is not going to do well.
Yeah.
So, you know,
I don't think it'll threaten Deep Impact for that number seven slot that year.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. One thing I wanted to briefly bring up, and I'm glad I was able to talk about Permanent Midnight really quickly, because that's my favorite
great
movie.
Fucking movie. And I, by the way, Ken, I mean, immediately go come over someday and watch that movie. It is
it's fucking good. It's an incredible, it's a really, and like Maria Bello, there's a scene between Ben Stiller and Maria Bello that's still one of my favorite acted scenes of all time. It's not done in normal coverage. It's just a single wide shot that's like 4 minutes long, and it's just amazing. It's just incredible acting.
Sounds awesome.
And so, anyways, one of the things I thought, because I really wanted to go off of the point that was made earlier, that we kind of were matriculating from the traditional action, the paradigm of action films as they existed in the 80s. There was the sort of that last gasp that ran of them, and then the overt failure of Last Action Hero, I think, is what kind of we were like, okay, well, we're gonna kind of put all of our eggs into different baskets and kind of test the waters there. But what there were a lot of were sort of these kind of crime, like Lock Stock is one of them, that were the crime stories that were told in this sort of twisted or interesting way. Whether it was in construction or delivery or characterization, Run Lola Run, which was a huge kind of revelation. Tong Tickfer, I mean, his second movie absolutely blew my mind. I remember seeing that movie and just like, I want everybody I know to see this movie.
Yeah.
But then other movies like A Simple Plan, Sam Raimi's A Simple Plan.
Yep.
Very, very Coen-esque in its the way it came, but really interesting, fun crime story, Lock, Stock. And then all the way even into you talked about Ronin. That's more of a straight action film, straight out of the Frankenheimer thing. But Ronin, 100%. I think, is still one of the best espionage movies of the 90s. I think that it's the movie that I think when Bond got sort of rediscovered with the whole Daniel Craig Casino Royale thing, I felt like they went back and they looked at all the 90s Bond movies and they were like, let's make Ronin instead. Yeah. Like they're like, let's bring it back to like,
a great point.
This is fucking, and let's make it as in the, like, as opposed to making the set pieces about whimsy, let's make them as intense as fucking possible.
Yeah.
And that's
still the best car chases in that film. Like, anyone listening to this who hasn't seen Ronin, like, and if you like spy movies, you've got to watch it. Out of Sight.
Yeah.
That was the last one. Yeah.
This is a huge movie for me.
Crime movie. Like, from that, I mean, you talk about, I mean, helping to, like, you know, I don't know if we can say launch George Clooney. I'm sure he was already launched, but, you know, this put him into like another level in the atmosphere. Jennifer Lopez is incandescent in this film. It's Soderbergh.
I'm not a big fan. It's her only great performance, I think, in her entire, and it's phenomenally good. Like, and the chemistry between the two of them in that trunk scene, that is a legit, like, 10-minute scene in a red lit, brake lit trunk.
I don't know. I mean, like, have you seen Made in Manhattan?
Thought you were going to go serious and maybe say Hustlers on that one. But that's the best appearance of her asshole in the movie. But
is her best role. But that shows you what a great director, with somebody who has a kind of singular focus.
Like, if Soderbergh can get Gina Carano to be, like, you know, really compelling for like an hour and a half, then yeah, he's a great director.
But also, I mean, just like that's what another thing, what chemistry kills, dude. And like with Lopez and Clooney, it was fucking sizzling. I mean, that's
everybody.
Like,
also, but also the rounding out of that cast, from Steve Zahn to Don Cheadle to Albert Brooks, like fucking everyone in that movie is on their A game. And this is one of the only successful, and I hesitate to say it because Elmore Leonard predates Tarantino and Pulp Fiction, but we've talked about it in the podcast before. From 96 to 2000, there were so many Pulp Fiction ripoffs that just happened. You've got things like Eight Heads in a Duffel Bag, and
including Tarantino trying to rip off himself and Jackie Brown. And
exactly. Like they're all of these movies. There's the one with James Spader and Charlize Theron, Two Days in the Valley. Like, there are all of these movies that came out at the time, but out of sight, out of all of the ones, it feels kind of in that Tarantino vibe is done so much better than any of those other other films, and plays so great. Like that is in my top three probably of 98, which, and that's saying a lot, because there's a lot of really good fucking movies that year. But
there's a lot of love that movie this year. It's that's a movie out of sight on this list where it feels timeless, you know, like it'll I bet you people in 50 years are going to watch that movie in the way that like we watch Casablanca or something, you know.
Sure. Well, I mean, so to kind of round out the conversation though, do we remember, do you remember what the other two movies were that were nominated for Best Picture besides Shakespeare in Love, which I know we haven't really talked about yet, The Saving Thin Red Private Line Ryan. And Saving Private Ryan.
Was it?
Remember, Saving Private Ryan and Thin Red Line were both.
Wasn't this the? This was what's his name? The guy that jumped up on the chair and Beautiful Life. No, the Italian Roberto Benigni, right?
Oh,
this is a Beautiful Life, right?
Life is beautiful.
Life is beautiful.
This won everything. Like Life is Beautiful. Well, he won Best Actor.
Tom Cruise. God damn it.
yeah, Life is Beautiful must have been nominated, right? Gods and Monsters.
Gods and Monsters is a great movie that I wanted to bring up.
I think that was nominated. I mean, certainly, like, people were nominated in it.
I still remember seeing Gods and Monsters, and that was the first time I was like, oh, Brendan Fraser can act.
I do know what the other one is, and it's also the person that lost Best Actress that maybe should have got, even though I do not actually care for this movie very much, and I love Shakespeare in Love, but the big competition for Shakespeare in Love was Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, yeah.
The period, yeah. And that was Kate Blanchett's introduction. And I really don't like Elizabeth very much. And I really like Shakespeare in Love. And I hate that it's the fucking, it's the popcorn. I know it's the fucking popcorn movie of the two. And it's the obvious movie of the two. And it's a lot of Weinstein. But I fucking love Shakespeare in Love. I really do.
Is a way better. Like, I enjoy that movie a lot more than Elizabeth. Elizabeth is a very, I've seen period pieces like that very, very often.
Sure.
Shakespeare in Love with Tom Stoppard.
Hell yeah.
Playwright coming in to do that language. It is really smart. Tom Wilkins is great in it. Wilkinson?
Jeffrey Rush. Yeah, Tom Wilkinson, okay. Jeffrey Rush. Great. Ben Affleck delivers some phenomenally good line deliveries in that movie. Yes.
Still to this day, I mean, like, it does say something too. And I think that that Shakespeare in Love is looked at retroactively is a lot, because at the time it was kind of a big thing that it won. And everyone was just like, people, this is such a forgettable popcorn movie where like these pieces of art with Saving Private Ryan and Thin Red Line didn't win. But in retrospect, a lot of people gave that movie a lot more run for being clever, because it really is funny and it's very clever and it's really well made and it's really well acted. And to this day, like, I still quote that movie all the time. Yeah. I don't know. It's a mystery. I say that all the fucking time.
I have said that in both of the shows that I'm in that have seemed like they're doomed. They're like, it'll work out. I'm like, how will it? It's a mystery. I also think what's brilliant about that screenplay, and it is a lot of Stoppard on there, but also John Madden, who directed wrote it, not the other John Madden, which always confused me very much in 1998. Right. But what they do with my least favorite Shakespearean play, which is Romeo and Juliet, and how they tie it into this retcon of Twelfth Night at the end of the movie. And Twelfth Night is one of my favorite pieces of Shakespeare. And the idea that these two are linked and interspersed with this fantasy of like, how are they going to keep their romance going? We're going to build this story that's this shipwrecked people and they're the mistaken identities and they fall in love and they don't know and all this stuff. And it's so fucking clever. Like, I know it's probably a little precious, but it's fucking clever.
Before that was like
a thing. Yeah.
But it's not. It saves itself by not being precious because they don't wind up together.
Yeah.
And because, you know, it is a tragedy. And that's it to me, like, along the lines of what you're saying, Matt, Romeo and Juliet, like the play, always struck me as kind of uneven and kind of a mess and stuff like that. And this kind of explains that in its own way. Obviously, it's heavily, you know, it's a fiction, right? But it still feels authentic, like emotionally. Sure. That's a credit to the actors and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah. One of the other things I thought was interesting too is I remember seeing that for the first time. That was one I didn't catch in the theaters. I saw right before because it was towards the end of the year when it came out, and I think that they intentionally released it on video like the week of the Oscars, whatever, like they used to do.
Both it and Saving Private Ryan were at the very end of that of 98 going into.
Well, I saw those in the theater. I think I saw all of the other Best Picture nominees in the theater. I saw Life is Beautiful in the theater. I remember seeing the other ones that were kind of up for it. Like Truman Show wasn't nominated, but I was up, you know.
Which is a shame.
It is a shame.
But anyways, I still remember watching that with my mom, or Shakespeare in Love, and thinking like the guy who plays, you know, her the Duke or to-be suitor is Colin Firth, who I didn't know at that point as an actor. I was just like, and I thought in my head, I was like, this guy's a fucking dick. Like, I was like, I know from here on out, whoever this guy plays, I'm just going to fucking hate him.
Isn't it?
And I didn't even realize when I saw Bridget Jones's Diary, it was the same fucking guy. Like, the roles were that much, like that. He was so good as
this
that.
This is another really, I'm really glad you're pulling this this performance up, because like this is Colin Firth breaking Bad, right? Because he was Darcy, right? In everybody's most all our moms, their favorite version of Pride and Prejudice is the miniseries with this dude like getting out of the lake,
right?
You know, like that he's the guy, and to see him in this and like, you know, the way he like sarcastically bows, he's like, the tide waits for no man, but I swear it waits for thee, you know, like, I mean, he's like such a douchebag. It's so good, he's so great. But yeah, it's a credit to him that like, yeah, you can like him again. He's amazing. I rewatched a Single Man recently and I'm like, god, he's great in this.
He's a really great actor, and just one of those guys that really understands what he's doing really well. Definitely a much, I'd say, even though I think, god damn it, he's won an Oscar.
King's Speech.
It had to be,
yeah. So, but that's what I was going to say, is that I think that it's insane because you forget how good of an actor he actually is, just because, you know, he's been in a lot of stuff, he's done a lot of work, and he's kind of consistent.
Didn't Judi Dench win for this?
She did for like five minutes of screen time. I think she was the. I don't think she still had. Someone else just beat her out for.
No, she won.
No. I'm saying, but someone beat her out for less time on screen to win.
It was
something recently.
Manchester by the Sea or Manchester
Orchestra by
Casey
the Sea.
Affleck?
Yeah, the Casey Affleck thing.
Who was I don't remember.
It was
Michelle Williams won for best supporting actress in that, as she was the ex-wife of him.
Yeah. I remember.
She's basically in one scene.
Hold on. So 10 actors.
Michelle Williams. It's Manchester by the.
I was trying to see. There's Anthony Hopkins is on the list for shortest time. Jared Leto for Dallas Buyers Club. So Silence of the Lambs, he was only in 16 minutes. Anne Hathaway was in Les Mis for 15 minutes.
No, Michelle Williams was in Manchester.
I'm just going through Judi Dench number 2, and number 1, Beatrice Straight in Network, 5 minutes. Williams is in Manchester by the Sea for more than that time.
Beatrice Williams.
Someone named Beatrice Williams. And I've seen Network. I don't even remember her in that. Well, I mean, she's only in for 5 minutes, so that would explain that. But we have run a bit over at this point. Yeah. I could sit and talk about 98 with you guys for many, many more hours at this point. So maybe this will be another one of the. We always talk about coming back to these podcasts. We don't always do it.
Like, let's do.
But I think
like
we might. I think maybe over the next year we're going to start tying up some of these podcasts that we have left open-ended, let's say.
I would love to. Can I just roll
absolutely
off, like some of my other favorite movies from like there's like Half-Baked came out like at the beginning of this year. Talking about the last gasp of the 90s, Spice World came out in 98. The Crichton Michael Crichton stuff, Sphere, came out in this year. We barely, you know, Dark City, American History X. Can I throw Two Fingers to the Sky for Kissing a Fool? A very underrated romantic comedy.
I'm a big fan of that movie. We've talked about that one.
Big fan of this movie.
Yes, that is actually. You know what's really sad though? That is a funny movie, by the way, because someone that both of you guys have met before, who sadly passed away, Chez Pazienza, had a real hard time with someone who, do you know who wrote Kissing a Fool?
No.
You're going to, it's going to, I apologize because it will potentially ruin the movie for you.
Oh, God damn it.
But the writer of A Million Little Pieces, the guy that faked the story, James Frey, he is the writer of Kissing a Fool. So I remember when Chez released his book, Death Star Twilight, Dark Star Twilight, which is very much a similar story, but actually true. Really got upset, and he was like, and so I remember one day I brought up Kissing a Fool, and he was like, "You fucking asshole!" And I'm like, "But it's a good movie." And I'm like, "Oh shit, it's written by James Frey, which is kind of crazy."
That sucks. Yeah, you're right. You should have not told me that. I'm just gonna keep going real quick. Yeah. Primary Colors. He got Game.
So Primary Colors is a phenomenally underrated.
It's so underrated. Fear and Loathing, you mentioned before, Ben. We didn't talk about Can't Hardly Wait. Dirty Work, which is directed by Bob Saget.
Yeah.
Somehow I didn't know. Mulan, Pi. Let's see. Oh, my God.
Mulan.
And then, like, In the Ronin Zone, these films all came out back to back to back to back. All start with R. Rounders, Rush Hour, Ronin, Rushmore. Like, all the same times in, I think it's in November. Apt Pupil.
Shit, that is a God. Bryan Singer's kickoff. That's fucking Bryan great Singer's, movie.
That's the other another one where it's like, oh, it's
well,
the,
no,
like
his kickoff was Usual X-Men. Suspects.
So
was
oh, that's right, that's right. Sorry, you're correct.
God, this was after Usual Suspects.
Yeah. Usual Suspects was '95.
Yeah. Well, shit.
And then like they give him X-Men, and you know, then very bad things. Waking Ned Divine. I watch it like every year with my wife. We fucking love it. Love
it's a
that
great movie.
Yeah, You've Got Mail, Thin Red Line, Faculty, and Affliction. Nick Nolte.
Go, Ben.
Yeah, the Affliction's a good one, too. I know, I really meant, I'm so sorry, I have to bring up the last one, which was, I can't believe I didn't even bring it up previously, because there was one action movie that really did, like, kind of set itself aside and kind of mold itself a little bit after some of those older, like the 80s and early 90s movies. And that's Three Ninjas High Noon at Mega Mountain.
I thought you were going another direction with this, but I was going to launch into a whole thing when you're talking about the action movies and kind of what is the death of action movies in summer. There was a summer tentpole in 1998 that was supposed to be the biggest movie of the year, and it failed so spectacularly that I feel it killed off that genre until superhero movies came back in with X-Men to revive it. Do you know what the movie is?
It's a superhero movie?
No, it is one of the last big action summer tentpoles, and it failed. It spectacularly failed.
I feel like I looked this up.
Dean Devlin and Roland Emmerich.
Oh, was it Godzilla?
It was Godzilla. It was 1998, and that movie was supposed to be merchandising movie.
That wasn't
movie.
An action movie, guess though. That was just an event movie.
I consider it to be an action movie.
Like, no one can make that movie. I've never seen a Godzilla movie I've liked.
Uh-oh. Ben's going to have some words with you there.
And on that note, we'll wrap it up. Thank you for listening to the New Way podcast.
I agree with you. We want to thank you so much for listening. We ran a little long, but you know what? You guys have been complaining about not having New Way, and now you just got a little extra 15 minutes of New Way past our normal runtime. Ken, thank you so much for joining us once again. We will have many more of these.
Yeah, thanks, Ken.
If you guys are big X-Men fans, we are going to have a super geek out fest with one of our listeners out there right now, Elizabeth, who's probably listening. She's on board, and Nick as well. We got lots of fun stuff coming up.
I better be invited to that because I'm a huge.
You are. It's basically you and Nick and Elizabeth, and Ben. And Ben, however much Ben wants to be involved in it, but this is like the actual comic shit.
I used to feel like I'm a man.
You are going through radiation, so you are kind of like an X-Men yourself. So with a lot of special powers, but
chemotherapy, Matt, get it right.
You are twice the man.
You have 10 times the strength of a normal man, and twice the sex appeal.
One might say a proto man.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for listening. We will talk to you soon. We got lots coming up for you, so keep tuned in. Talk to you then. Cheers.